carefully, Helen. Be sure the children do not see it until this evening when it is dressed. How much?
15 cents, ma'am.
Here's a quarter.
Tell them keep the change.
Yes, ma'am.
La da 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 da.
Is that my little skylark twittering out there?
Yes, it is.
My little squirrel bustling about?
Yes.
When did my squirrel come home?
Just now. Come, Torvald, and see what I have bought.
Don't disturb me. Mm-hmm. What did you say? Mm-hmm. All these things? Has my little spendthrift been wasting money again?
Yes, Torvald, but this year we can really let ourselves go a little. This is the first Christmas we have not needed to economize.
Still, you know we can't afford to spend money recklessly.
Yes, well, we may be a bit more reckless now, maybe, just a tiny wee bit. You're going to have a big salary and earn lots of money.
Yes, after the new year. And then it will still be a whole quarter before the salary is due.
Who we can borrow until then.
Nora, my same little featherweight. Suppose I were to borrow $300, say, and you spent it all on the Christmas wreath, and then we had nothing left.
Well, if that were to happen, or anything were to happen to you, I don't suppose I should care whether I owed money or not.
Yes, but what if something did happen to me? What about the people who had lent the money?
They? Well, who would bother about them? I should not know who they were.
That is like a woman. But seriously, Nora, you know how I feel about these things. No debt, no borrowing. There'd be no beauty or freedom about a home life that relies on borrowing and debt. Now, we two have kept rightly to the straight road so far, and we will continue along the same way for the short while longer there be any struggle.
As you please, Torvald.
There, my little skylark must have drooped her wings. What is this? Is my little squirrel out of temper? Nora, what do you think I have got here?
Money!
There you go.
$15, thank you, Tobo.
Do you think I don't know what a lot is wanted for housekeeping at Christmas time?
That will keep me going for a long time.
Indeed.
But come.
It must.
come and see what I've bought. And all so cheap. A doll for Emmy, and a doll for Elizabeth, and a blanket for John, and dress lengths and handkerchiefs for the maids. Old Anne really deserves something fine.
Ah, and what is in this parcel here?
Oh, you mustn't see that until this evening.
Very well. And now tell me, you extravagant little person, what would you like for yourself?
Well, for myself? I'm sure I don't want anything.
Yes, but you must. Now, tell me something reasonable that you would particularly like to have.
I really can't think of anything, Torvald, unless...
Unless?
Well, if you really want to get me something, you might...
Well,
you might give me money. Only just as much as you can afford, and then one of these days I'll buy something
with
it.
But Nora!
Oh, do, Torvald, then we could wrap it in beautiful gold paper and hang it on the Christmas tree. Won't that be fun?
What are little people called that are always wasting money?
Spendthrifts? I know. Let us do as you suggest, Torvald, and then I shall have time to think of what I am most in want of. That is a very sensible plan, isn't it?
Indeed it is. That is to say, if you were really to save out of the money I give you, and you were to buy something for yourself. But if you spend it all on housekeeping and any number of unnecessary things, I merely have to pay up again.
Oh, but Torvald!
Ah, Nora, you can't deny it. You know that it is true. She is a sweet little spendthrift, but she spends a deal of money. One can hardly believe how expensive such little persons are.
It's a shame to say that I really do save all I can.
Yes, that is true, all you can. But you can't save anything.
You haven't any idea how many expenses we skylarks and squirrels have, Torvald.
You are an odd little soul. You're very much like your father. You always find some new way of wheedling money out of me, and then when you have gotten it, it seems to melt in your hands. You never know where it has gone. But still, one must take you as you are, I suppose. It is in the blood, for indeed it is true, Nora, that these things can be inherited.
I wish I'd inherited many of Papa's qualities.
I would not wish you to be anything other than just what you are. My sweet little Skylar. But do you know that it strikes me that you're looking rather, how shall I say this, uneasy today?
Do I?
Yes, you do, really. Now, turn around, look straight at me.
Well?
Has little Miss Sweet Tooth been breaking rules in town today?
No, what makes you think that?
Hasn't she paid a visit to the confectioners?
No, I assure you.
Not been nibbling on sweets?
No, really, don't.
Not even taking a bite of a macaroon or two?
No, no, certainly not.
There. Of course, I was only joking.
I wouldn't dream of going against your wishes.
I should think not, especially since you gave me your word on it. Very well. Keep your little Christmas secrets to yourself, my darling. They will all be revealed tonight when the tree is lit, no doubt.
Did you remember to invite Dr. Rang?
No, but there is no need. He will come, as a matter of course, to dinner with us. However, I will rewind him when he comes in the morning. I have brought some good wine, Nora. You cannot think how I am looking forward to this evening.
Well, so am I. The children will enjoy themselves.
It is splendid to feel that one has a perfectly safe appointment in life and a big enough income. Isn't that delightful to think of?
Yes, it really is wonderful.
Do you remember last Christmas? For a full 3 weeks beforehand, you shut yourself up every night until well after midnight, making ornaments for the Christmas tree and all the other fine things that you were doing surprises with. It was the dullest 3 weeks I ever spent.
I didn't find it dull.
Was a precious little result, Nora.
You really shouldn't tease me about that again. How could I help the cats going in and tearing everything to pieces?
Of course you couldn't, you poor little child. You had the best of intentions of pleasing us all, and that's the main thing. But still, it's a good thing that our hard times are over.
Yes, it really is wonderful.
And I needn't sit here and be dull all by myself, and you need not ruin your dear eyes or your pretty little hands.
Oh, no, I needn't any more, need I, Torgle? It's wonderfully lovely to hear you say so. Yeah, I want to tell you how I've been thinking we ought to arrange things. Oh, there's a bell. What a nuisance.
If it is a call, remember, I am not at home.
Excuse me, ma'am. There's a lady to see you, a stranger.
I'll ask her to come in.
Yes, ma'am. And the doctor has come at the same time, sir.
Oh, did he go straight into my room?
Yes, sir.
How do you do, Nora?
How do you do?
Oh, you don't recognize me, I suppose.
I'm sorry. Oh, Christine, is it really you?
Yes, it is I.
Oh, Christine, to think of my not recognizing you. How could I? I have altered, Christine.
Yes, indeed, I have in 10 long years.
Is it so long since we met? I suppose it is. Well, these last 8 years have been a happy time for me, I can tell you. Oh, and so now you've taken this long journey in winter. That was plucky of you.
I arrived by steamer this morning.
To have some fun at Christmas time, I suppose. How delightful. But take off your things. You are not cold, I hope. There. Now, let us sit by the stove and be cozy. Here, you take the seat by the stove and I'll take the rocker. Oh, Christine, now you look like your old self again. You are a little paler, Christine. Perhaps a little thinner.
Much, much older.
Perhaps a little older, very little, certainly not much. Oh, would you forgive my chattering on like this?
What do you mean, Nora?
Dear Christine, you are a widow.
Yes, it's been 3 years ago now.
I knew at the time. I meant ever so often to write, but I always put it off, and something always prevented me.
I quite understand, dear.
It was very bad of me. You must have suffered, and he left you nothing?
No.
No children?
No.
Nothing at all, then?
Not even to grief or sorrow to live upon.
Is that possible?
It sometimes happens, Nora.
You are quite alone. How dreadfully sad that must be. Oh, I have three lovely children. You can't see them now, for the girls are out with their nurse and the baby's sleeping. Oh, but you must tell me all about it.
No, I want to hear about you, Nora.
Oh, no, no, I mustn't be selfish today. Today I must only think of your affairs. But there is one thing I just must tell you. Do you know we have just had a great piece of good luck?
No, what is it?
Oh, just fancy. My husband has been made manager of the bank.
Your husband? Well, what good luck.
Oh, yes, tremendous. A barrister's profession is such an uncertain thing, especially if you will not take unsavory cases. And naturally, my Torvald has never been willing to do that. And I quite agree with him. He's to take up his work in the bank at the new year, and then we will have a big salary and lots of money. Splendid to have heaps of money and not need to have any anxiety, won't it?
Yes. I think it would be delightful to have everything one needs.
Not just what one needs, but heaps and heaps of money.
Nora! Nora, haven't you learned any sense yet? In your school days, you were a great spendthrift.
Yes, that's what Torvald says. But Nora is not so silly as you think. We have not been in a position for me to waste money, you know. We have both had to work.
You too?
Oh, yes. Odds and ends. Needlework, crochet work, embroidery, and that sort of thing. You know, Torvald left his office when we were married. There was no prospect of promotion there, and he had to try and earn even more than before, but he overworked himself and fell dreadfully ill. The doctor said it was necessary for him to go to Italy for the warm climate.
You spent a whole year in Italy, didn't you?
Yes. It was no easy matter to get away, I can tell you. I was expecting my little Emmy's birth every day, and I had my poor sick Torvald to look after. It was a wonderfully beautiful journey, and it saved Torvald's life, but it cost a tremendous amount of money, Christine.
So I should think.
It cost $1,000. That's a lot, isn't it?
Oh, yes. Well, in an emergency, it's lucky to have the money.
Well, I ought to tell you we got it from Papa.
Oh, I see. Your father died about that time, didn't he?
Yes. Just think of it. I couldn't go and visit him. I had my poor sick Torvald to look after. I never saw him again, my poor dear father. That was the saddest time I've known since our marriage.
I know how fond of him you were. Then you went off to Italy.
Oh, yes, we started a month later.
And your husband, did he come back quite well?
As sound as a bell.
But the doctor...
What doctor?
Well, I thought I heard the maid say that the gentleman who arrived at the same time as I was the doctor.
Oh, yes, that was Dr. Rank, but he doesn't come here professionally. No, he is Torvald's most intimate friend and a dear friend of mine, too. No. Torvald has not had an hour's illness since then, and my children are alive and happy, and so am I. Oh, Christine, it's so good to be alive and happy. But how horrid of me. I'm talking of nothing but my own affairs. Tell me, is it true you did not love your husband? Why did you marry him?
Well, my mother was alive then. She was bedridden and helpless, and I had to provide for my two little brothers. I didn't feel I was justified in refusing his offer.
Oh, perhaps you were quite right. He was rich at the time, then.
I believed he was quite well off. His business was a precarious one. And after he died, it fell to pieces, and there was nothing left.
And then?
I had to turn my hand at anything I could find. First, there was a small school, then a small shop, and so on. The last 3 years have been like one long working day without any rest. But now it's over, because my mother doesn't need me anymore. She's gone. And my brothers don't need me either, because they both have positions and can fend for themselves.
Well, then what a relief you must feel if...
Indeed. My life is so unspeakably empty. I feel...
I feel so alone. I don't have anyone to live for anymore. That's why I left my town and I came here. I was hoping I might find something to busy me and occupy my thoughts. Maybe I'd be lucky enough to get some regular work, office work of some sort.
But that is so frightfully tiring, and you look tired already. Best go off to some health resort.
I have no father to give me money to go on a journey, Nora.
Don't be angry with me.
You who shouldn't be angry with me. The worst of a position like mine, it makes you so bitter. Nobody to work for, still always on the lookout for chances. One must live so one gets selfish. When you told me of the good fortune your life had taken, you won't believe this, I wasn't so delighted on your behalf as I was on my own.
I don't understand. Oh, I know. You mean perhaps Torvald could get you something to do.
Yes, that's what I was thinking.
Oh, he must. He must. Just leave it to me. I will broach the subject very cleverly. I will think of something that will please him very much. It will make me so happy to be of some use to you.
Oh, how kind you are, Nora, to be so anxious to help me. Mm. And it's doubly kind in you, because you know so little of the burdens and troubles of life.
I know so little of them.
Oh, well, small household cares and things of that sort. Oh, you're a child, Nora.
You ought not to be so superior.
No.
You're just like the others. They all think I'm incapable of anything really serious.
Oh, come, come.
I've gone through nothing in this world of cares.
But Nora, you've just told me all of your troubles.
Pooh, those were trifles. I have not told you the important thing.
The important thing? What do you mean?
You look down upon me altogether, but you ought not to. You are proud, aren't you, of having worked so long and hard for your mother?
Indeed. And I don't look down on anyone. Yes. I am both proud and glad to have had the privilege to make the end of my mother's life almost free from care.
And are you proud to think of what you have done for your brothers?
I think I have the right to be.
I think so too. But now listen to this. I too have something to be proud and glad of.
Oh, I have no doubt you do. And what do you refer to?
Hush. Suppose Torvald were to hear. He ought not to. Not on any account. No one in the world must know, Christine, except you.
Oh, what is it? Come and sit.
It was I who saved Torvald's life.
Saved? How?
Well, I told you about our trip to Italy. Torvald never would have recovered if we hadn't gone there.
Yes, but your father gave you the necessary funds.
Yes, that is what Torvald and all of the others think, but...
But?
Papa didn't give us a penny. It was I who procured the money.
You? All that large sum?
$1,000. What do you think of that?
Well, how could you possibly do it? Did you win the prize in the lottery?
In the lottery? There would have been no credit in that.
But where did you get all that money? Because you couldn't have borrowed it.
Couldn't I? Why not?
No. A wife cannot borrow money without her husband's consent.
Well, if it is a wife who has any head for business, a wife who has the wit to be a little bit clever.
Nora, I don't understand at all.
Well, there is no need you should. I never said I borrowed the money. Perhaps I got it some other way. Perhaps I got it from some rich secret admirer, when anyone is as attractive as I am.
You mad creature.
Well, now you're full of curiosity, Christine.
Nora, listen to me. Don't you think you've been a little bit imprudent?
Is it imprudent to save your husband's life?
Well, I feel that it's imprudent without his knowledge.
But it was absolutely necessary. He should not know. My goodness, can't you understand that? Do you think I didn't try to get what I wanted as if it were for myself? I told him I should love to travel abroad like other young wives. I tried tears and entreaties with him. I even hinted he might raise a loan. That really made him angry, Christine. Very well, I thought. You must be saved, and that is how I came to devise a way out of the difficulty.
Did your husband ever get to know from your father that it wasn't he who lent you the money?
No. I had meant to let Papa in on the secret and beg him never to reveal it, but alas, he was so ill then, and then there was never any need to tell him.
And since that time, you've never revealed your secret to your husband?
Well, good heavens, no! How could you think so? A man who has such strong opinions on these things? And besides, how painful and humiliating it would be for Torvald to know he owed me anything. It would upset our mutual relations altogether, and our beautiful, happy home would no longer be what it is now.
Do you mean never to tell him about it?
Perhaps someday, when I am no longer as nice looking as I am now, then it may be a good thing to have something in reserve. But nonsense. That day will never come. So, what do you think of my great secret, Christine? Do you still think I am of no use? I can tell you, it has been by no means easy to meet my engagements punctually. I could not take from my housekeeping money, for Torvald must eat well. And I could not let my children be shabbily dressed, the sweet darlings.
So it's all had to come out of your own necessities of life.
Oh, yes. Besides, I was the one responsible for it. So, whenever Torvald has given me money for new dresses and such things, I never spent more than half of it. I always bought the simplest, cheapest things, and thank heaven any clothes will look well on me, so he's never noticed. But it has been very hard on me, Christine, because it's delightful to be well-dressed, isn't it?
Quite so.
Well, then, I have found other ways of earning money. For example, last Christmas I was lucky enough to get a lot of copying to do, and so I sat up writing every night until quite late at night. It was a tremendous pleasure to be sitting there and earning money. It was like being a man.
How much have you been able to pay off in that way?
I can't tell you exactly. I only know I have paid every penny I could. Many a time I was at my wit's end. Then I would sit here and imagine a rich old man had fallen in love with me.
What? Who is that man?
And that he died, and when his will was opened up, it contained written the instruction, the lovely Mrs. Nora Helmer is to have all I possess paid over at once in cash.
Nora. Who is that man?
Oh, can't you understand? There was no old gentleman. It was just something I would sit here and imagine when I couldn't think of any other solution. No, that tiresome old man can stay where he is. I don't need him, or his will either. For now, I'm free from care. Think of it, Christine. Free from care to be able to play and romp with the children, and to keep the house just as Torvald likes it. Free from care!
Free from care! That's the bell. I'd better go.
Oh, no. It is sure to be for Torvald. Don't go.
Excuse me, ma'am. There's a gentleman to see the master. And if the doctor is with him...
Well, who is it?
It is I, Mrs. Helmer.
You? What do you want to see my husband about?
No, bank business, in a way. I have a small post in the bank, and I hear your husband is to be our chief.
Then it is...
Dry business matters, Mrs. Helmer. And absolutely nothing else.
Be so good as to go into the study, then.
Nora, who is that man?
A lawyer of the name Crogston.
Really, is he?
You know the man?
Yes, I used to, many years ago. He was a solicitor's clerk in the town where I lived.
Yes, he was.
He He's greatly altered.
He made a very unhappy marriage.
He's a widower now, isn't he?
With several children.
They say that he carries on many kinds of business.
Really? Well, I don't know anything about it. Let us not talk of business. It is so tiresome.
Ah, no, my dear fellow, I won't disturb you. I would rather go into your wife for a little while. Oh, I beg your pardon. I'm afraid I'm disturbing you, too.
Not at all. Dr. Rank, Mrs. Lynn.
Ah, Mrs. Elfin, heard the name Mrs. Lynn mentioned here. I believe I passed you on the stairs when I arrived, Mrs. Lynn.
Yes, I go very slowly. I can't manage stairs well.
Oh, some slight internal weakness.
No, it seems I've been overworking myself.
Oh, nothing more than that. Then I suppose you came to town to amuse yourself with our entertainments.
I came to look for work.
Is that a good cure for overwork?
Well, one must live, Dr. Rank.
Yes, the general assumption is that it is necessary.
Look here, Dr. Rank, you know you want to live.
Oh, yes. I mean, however wretched I may feel, I want to prolong the agony as long as possible. All of my patients feel that way, and so do the morally diseased. One of whom, in a bad case, too, is at this very moment with Helmer.
Oh, whom do you mean?
A lawyer, name of Krogstad. Fellow you don't know at all. He suffers from a diseased moral character, Mrs. Helmer. And yet, even he talked about how important it is that he should live.
Really? Well, what did he want to speak with Torvald about?
I have no idea. I only heard that it had something to do with the bank.
I didn't know that this what's-his-name Krogstad fellow had anything to do with the bank.
Oh, he has some sort of appointment there. Mrs. Lynn, I don't know if you find also in your part of the world that there are those that go snuffing about, trying to smell out moral corruption, and when they have found some, they place the person concerned in a lucrative position where they can keep an eye on him. Healthy natures are left out in the cold.
Well, I still think the sick are those who most need taking care of.
Oh yes, there you are. That's the sentiment that's turning society into a sick house. What are you laughing at? Have you any notion of what society really is?
What do I care about tiresome society? I am laughing at something completely different, something extremely amusing. Tell me, Dr. Rank, are all of the people employed in the bank dependent on Torvald now?
And that's what you find so extremely amusing?
Well, that's my affair. It's perfectly glorious to think that we have, that Torvald has so much power over so many people. Dr. Rank, what do you say to a macaroon?
What macaroons? I thought they were forbidden here.
Oh, yes, but these are some Christine gave me.
What? I didn't give you any.
Don't be alarmed. You couldn't have known that Torvald had forbidden them. I should tell you he's afraid they will spoil my teeth, but once in a while. Isn't that so, Dr. Ray?
Well, I did
say for sure. By your leave. And you must have one too, Christine. And I will have one, just a tiny one.
Very good.
I am tremendously happy. There's just one thing now I should dearly love to do.
And what is that?
Well, it's something I should dearly love to say. If Torvald could hear me, of course.
Then why can't you say it?
No, I daren't. It's so shocking.
Shocking?
Well, I should not advise you to say it then, but perhaps with us you might. What is it you would like so much to say if Torvald could hear you?
Well, I should just love to say, we'll all be damned!
Oh, man! Oh, we'll say it. Here he is.
Hush, hush. Well, Torvald, dear, have you gotten rid of him?
Yes, he has just gone out.
Let me introduce you. This is Christine, who's come into town.
Christine? Excuse me, but I
don't... Mrs. Lind, dear. Christine Lind.
Ah, yes, of course. A family friend of my wife's, no doubt.
Yes, we've known each other for many years.
And just think, she's taken this long journey in order to see you.
What do you mean?
No, really.
Yes, Christine is tremendously clever at bookkeeping. And she is frightfully anxious to work under some clever man so as to perfect herself.
Very sensible, Mrs. Lynn.
And when she heard you'd been appointed as manager in the bank, the news was telegraphed, you know. Well, she traveled here as quick as she could.
I'm sure you could find something for Christine, for my sake, couldn't you?
Well, I'm sure it would not be altogether impossible. I presume you are a widow, Mrs. Lynn?
Yes.
And you have had some experience of bookkeeping?
Yes, a fair amount.
Ah, well, then it is very likely that I will have something for you.
What did I tell you? What did I tell you?
You have just come in a most fortunate moment, Mrs. Lynn.
How can I thank you?
There is no need for that. For today, you must excuse me.
Wait a minute. I will go with you.
Oh, don't be long, Torvald, dear.
About an hour, not more.
Are you going too, Christine?
Yes, I must go and look for a room.
Ah, well then, we can walk down the street together.
What a shame we are of such short space.
Don't
here.
Even think about it. Thank you so much. Goodbye, Nora.
Goodbye for the present. Of course, you will come back this evening. And you too, Dr. Rank, what do you say? If you are well enough? Well, you must be. Wrap yourself up well. Oh, there they are! There they are, my darlings! Come in, come in. Oh, Christine, aren't they just darling?
I come, let's not stand here in the draft.
Come along, Mrs. Lynn. The place will only be bearable for a mother now.
Fresh and well you look. Such red cheeks like apples and roses. Have you had great fun?
Yes, Mother, we had great fun.
And did you build a snowman?
Yes, he was so big.
Oh my goodness!
We used buttons for his eyes and a carrot for his nose.
Oh, wonderful! Well, shall we have a game?
Yes.
And what shall we play?
Hide and seek.
Hide and seek? All right. Emmy, will you count?
Yes, Mother.
Elizabeth, real high. All right.
One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, ten. Ready or not, here I come.
Excuse me, but the outer door was ajar. I suppose someone forgot to shut it.
My husband is out, Mr. Croxton.
I know that.
Well, what do you want here, then?
A word with you.
With me? Go in with the nurse, dears. Go in with the nurse.
Mother, won't a stranger man hurt you?
Oh, no, no. The stranger man won't harm Mommy. Go in now, and we'll have a game when he is gone. You want to speak with me?
Yes, I do.
Today, it's not the first of the month.
No, it is Christmas Eve, and it shall depend upon yourself what kind of Christmas you will spend.
Well, what do you mean? Today it would be absolutely impossible.
We will not speak of that until later. This is something different. I presume you can spare me a moment.
Yes, I can, although...
Good. I was in Olson's restaurant, and I saw your husband going down the street.
Yes?
With a lady.
What then?
May I make so bold as to ask if it was a Mrs. Lynn?
It was.
Just arrived in town?
Yes, today.
She's a great friend of yours, isn't she?
She is, but I don't see...
I knew her, too. Once upon a time.
I'm aware of that.
Are you? So you know all about it. I bought as much. Well, then I can ask without beating around the bush. Is Mrs. Lynn to have an appointment at the bank?
What right have you to question me, Mr. Croxton? You, who are one of my husband's subordinates... But since you ask, you shall know. Yes, Mrs. Lynde is to have a position in the bank, and it was I who pleaded her case, let me tell you that.
I was right in what I thought then.
Sometimes one has a tiny bit of influence, I should hope. Because one is woman doesn't necessarily follow that... Well, when anyone is in a subordinate position, Mr. Croxton, they should really be careful to avoid offending anyone who
has influence?
Exactly.
Mrs. Helmer, you will be so good as to use your influence in my behalf.
What? What do you mean?
You'll be so kind as to see that I'm allowed to keep my subordinate position in the bank.
What do you mean? Who proposes to take your post away from me?
There is no need to continue with the pretense of ignorance. I quite understand your friend is not very eager to run the risk of rubbing shoulders with me. And I quite understand, too, who I have to thank for being let go.
But I assure you...
Very likely. but the time has come when I should advise you to use your influence to prevent that.
Mr. Cruxton, I have no influence.
Haven't you? I thought you said yourself, just now.
Well, naturally, I didn't mean for you to put that construction on it. What makes you think I have any influence of that kind over my...
Since his school days, I don't suppose he is any more unassailable than other husbands.
You speak slightingly of my husband, Mr. Cruxton. I shall turn you out of the house.
You are bold, Mrs. Helmer.
Well, I'm not afraid of you anymore. As soon as the new year comes, I shall in a very short time be free of this whole thing.
Listen to me, Mrs. Helmer. If necessary, I'm prepared to fight for my small post at the bank as if I were fighting for my life.
So it seems.
It's not just for the sake of the money. Indeed, that weighs least in the matter with me. It is something else. I might as well tell you. You probably know, like everyone else, that once, many years ago, I was guilty of an indiscretion.
I've heard something of the kind.
It never came to court. But after that, every way seemed closed to me, and so I took to the business that you know of. I had to do something, and honestly, I don't think I've been one of the worst. The time has come when I must cut myself free from all that. My sons are growing up, and for their sake, I must try to win back as much respect as I can in the town. This post at the bank was like the first step up for me. And now your husband wants to kick me downstairs again into the mud.
But you must believe me. It is not my power to help you at all.
That is because you haven't the will. But I have the means to compel you.
You don't mean you will tell my husband I owe you money?
Suppose I were to tell him.
It would be perfectly infamous of you to think of his learning my secret, which has been my pride and joy, in such an ugly way. They should hear it from you. It would put me in a horribly disagreeable position.
Only disagreeable?
I'll do it then. And it will be worse for you. My husband will see what a blackguard you are, and you certainly won't keep your post then.
I asked if it was only a disagreeable scene at home that you were afraid of.
My husband does get to know of it. Of course, he will at once pay you what is owing, and we shall have nothing more to do with you.
Mrs. Heller, you either have a very bad memory or else you know very little of business. As such, I will be obliged to remind you of a few details.
What do you mean?
When your husband was ill, you came to me to borrow $1,000.
Well, I didn't know who else to go to.
I promised to get you that amount.
Yes, and so you did?
I promised to get you that amount on certain conditions. Your mind was so taken up with your husband's illness, and you were so anxious to get the money for your journey, you don't seem to have paid any attention to the conditions of our bargain. And so I'll not be amiss if I remind you. Now, I promised to get you the money on the security of a bond which I drew up.
Yes, and which I signed.
Good. But under your signature were a few lines which constituted your father a surety for the money. Those lines he should have signed.
Should? He did sign them.
I left the date blank. That is to say, your father should have inserted the date on which he signed the paper. Do you remember that?
I think I remember.
I then gave you the paper which you were to send by post to your father. Is that not so?
Yes.
And naturally you did so at once. Because 5 or 6 days later, you brought me the bond with his signature, and I gave you the money.
Well, haven't I been paying it off regularly?
Fairly so. But to come to the matter at hand, it must have been a very trying time for you, Mrs. Helmer.
It was, indeed.
Your father was very ill, wasn't he?
Yes, he was very near his end.
And passed away soon after.
Yes.
Tell me, Mrs. Helmer, by any chance, would you remember the day on which your father passed away? The day of the month, I mean.
Died on the 29th of September.
That is correct. I have ascertained it for myself. And as that is the case, there is a discrepancy which I cannot account for.
What discrepancy? I don't...
The discrepancy lies in the fact that your father signed this bond 3 days after his death.
What? I don't understand.
Your father died on September 29th. But see here, he has dated his signature the 2nd of October. That is a discrepancy. Can you explain it? It is a remarkable thing, too, that the words 2nd of October and the year are not in your father's handwriting. But one that I think I know. Well, that's easily explained. Your father must have forgotten to date his signature, and someone inserted the date haphazard before learning of his death. There's no harm in that. It all depends on the signature. And that, I suppose, is genuine? Mrs. Helmer? It was your father himself who signed the paper here.
No, it was not. It was I who wrote Papa's name.
Are you aware that that is a dangerous confession?
In what way? You shall have your money soon.
Let me ask you a question. Why did you not send the paper to your father?
It was impossible. Papa was so ill at the time. If I would have asked him to sign it, I should have had to tell him what the money was to be used for. And since he was so ill himself, I could not tell him Torvald was very near his end. That was impossible.
Would have been better for you if you'd given up your trip abroad.
That trip was to save my husband's life. I couldn't give that up.
But did it never occur to you that you were committing a fraud on me?
I couldn't take that into account. I didn't trouble myself about you at all. I couldn't bear you because you put so many heartless difficulties in my way, although you knew what a dangerous condition my husband was in.
Mrs. Helmer, you evidently do not realize exactly what it is you've been guilty of. But let me assure you, my one misstep, which has cost me all my reputation, is nothing more and nothing worse than what you have done.
You ask me to believe you were brave enough to run a risk to save your wife's life?
The law cares nothing about motives.
Well, there must be a foolish law.
Well, foolish or not, it is the law by which you will be judged if I produce this paper in court.
I don't believe it. Is a daughter not allowed to spare her dying father anxiety and care? Is a wife not allowed to save her husband's life? I don't know much about the law, Mr. Crofton, but I am certain there must be laws permitting such things as that. Have you no knowledge of such laws, Mr. Crofton? You who are a lawyer? Well, you must be a very poor lawyer.
Perhaps. But in matters of business, such business as you and I have had, do you think I don't understand that? Very well, Mrs. Helmer, do as you please. But let me tell you, if I am to lose my position a second time, you will lose yours.
Like that. I am not so silly as he thinks. And yet, it is impossible. I did it for love's sake.
Mother, the stranger man has gone up to the gate.
Oh, yes, dear, but don't tell anyone about the stranger man, you hear? Not even Papa.
No, Mother, but will you come and play again? Please, please.
No, not now.
But Mother, you promised us.
I can't now. Run along, and I have such a lot to do.
That's not fair.
No. Helen! Helen, bring in the tree! No, it's impossible.
What shall we put there?
They're here on the table.
Can I get you anything else?
No, thank you. I have all I want. That horrible man. The tree will be spectacular. I will do everything I can think of to please you, Torvald. I will sing for you. I will dance for you. Oh, are you back already?
Yes. Has anyone been here?
Here? No.
Strange, I just saw Krogstad go out of the gate.
Oh, yes, I forgot Krogstad was here for a moment.
Nora, I can tell from your manner that he has been here begging you to say a good word for him.
Yes?
And that you were to appear to have done it of your own accord, and you were to conceal from me the fact of his having been here. Didn't he beg that of you, too?
Yes, Torvald.
And you would have a part in such a thing? To have any sort of talk at all with a man like that and offer him any sort of promise? And to tell me a lie in the bargain?
A lie?
Didn't you just say no one had been here? My little songbird must never do that again. A songbird must have a clean beak to chirp with. False notes. That is so, isn't it? Yes, I think it is. We shall say no more on the matter. How warm and snug it is in here.
Torvald?
Yes?
I'm
very much looking forward to the costume ball at the Stenborgs the day after tomorrow.
I am very curious to see what you are going to surprise me with.
Well, it was very silly of me to want to do that.
What do you mean?
Well, I can't hit upon anything that will do. Everything I think of seems so silly or insignificant.
Aha! Is my little Nora finally acknowledging that at last?
Torvald, are you very busy?
Well,
what are all of those papers?
Bank business.
Already?
Yes. The retiring manager has given me the authority to make the necessary changes in the staff and in the rearrangement of the work. I must make use of the Christmas week to do this so that everything will be in order by the new year.
And that was why poor Crogston. If you hadn't been so busy, Torvald, I should have asked you for a tremendously big favor.
Oh, what is that?
Well, there is no one who has such good taste as you, and, well, I do so want to look nice at the fancy dress ball, the Stenborgs. Couldn't you take me in hand and decide what I shall go as and what sort of dress I shall wear?
Ah, so my obstinate little woman is finally obliged to get someone to come to her rescue.
Yes, I can't get along a bit without your help.
Well, I will think it over. We shall manage to hit upon something.
That is nice of you. Tell me, was it something very terrible that this Crogston fellow was guilty of?
We forged someone's name. Do you have any idea what that means?
But isn't it possible he was driven to do so by necessity?
Or more likely, by imprudence. I am not so heartless as to condemn a man altogether because of a single false step of that kind.
Oh, no, you wouldn't, would you, dear?
Many a man has been able to retrieve his character if he has openly confessed his fault and taken his punishment.
Punishment?
But this Krogstad did nothing of the sort. He got out of it by a cunning trick, and that is why he has gone under altogether.
But do you think it would...
Just think how a guilty man like that has to lie and play the hypocrite in front of everyone. And to wear a mask in front of all those near and dear to him, even before his own wife and children. And about the children, Nora, that is the most terrible part of all.
How?
Because such an atmosphere of lies infects and poisons the whole life of a home. Every breath the children take in such a house is full of the germs of evil.
Are you very sure of that?
My dear, I have often run across it in the course of my life as a boy. Almost everyone who has gone through the bad early in life has had a deceitful mother.
Why do you only say mother?
Well, it just seems to be naturally the case of the mother's influence. Although, of course, a bad father's would have the same result. Now, this Krogstad has been persistently poisoning his children with lies and falsehoods, and that is why I say he has lost all moral character. That is why my sweet little Nora must promise me not to plead his cause. Give me your hand on that. Come, what is this? Give me your hand. There, now it is settled. And besides, I assure you, it would be quite impossible for me to work with him. I literally feel physically ill in the presence of such people.
It's so hot in here, and I have such a lot to do.
Yes, and I must go through these papers before dinner, and I must think about your costume. And I may just have something for you in gold paper to hang on the tree tonight, my sweet little singing bird.
No, it is impossible. It must be impossible.
The little ones are begging so hard to be allowed to come in to Mama.
Oh no, don't bring them into me. You must stay with the man.
Very well, ma'am.
Deprave my children. Poison my home. Oh, it isn't true. It can't possibly be true.
Yeah.
Someone is coming? No. No one will come today. Christmas Day. Nor tomorrow. But perhaps... No. The letterbox is quite empty. imagine.
At last, I found the box with the fancy costume.
Well, thanks. Put it on the table.
But it is very much in want of mending.
I should like to tear it into 100,000 pieces.
What an idea! It can easily be put in order. Just a little patience.
Yes. I will go and get Mrs. Lynn to help me with it.
What? Out again in this horrible weather? You will catch cold, ma'am, and make yourself ill.
Well, worse than that may happen. How are the children?
Oh, the poor little souls are playing with their Christmas presents.
Do they ask much for me?
Well, you see, they're so accustomed to having their mama with them.
I shall not be with them so much now as I was before.
Oh, well, young children easily get accustomed to anything.
Do you think so? Do you think they will forget their mother if she went away altogether?
Good heavens, went away altogether?
Nurse, come and sit. I want you to tell me something I have often wondered about. How could you have the heart to put your child out among strangers?
I was obliged to if I wanted to be little Nora's nurse.
How could you be willing to do it?
What? When I was going to get such a good place by it. A poor girl who's got into trouble should be glad to. Besides, that wicked man didn't do a single thing for me.
But I suppose your daughter has quite forgotten you.
Oh, no, indeed she hasn't. She wrote to me when she was confirmed and when she was married.
Oh, dear Anne, you were a good mother to me when I was little.
Oh, little Nora, poor dear, had no other mother but me.
And if my children had no other mother, I am sure you would... Nonsense, I am talking. Go into them now. And tomorrow you will see how charming I shall look.
I am sure there will be no one so charming as you at the ball.
If only I dare go out. If only I knew nothing would happen here in the meantime. And think about it. What lovely gloves! Out of my thoughts, out of my thoughts. There is someone coming. Oh, Christine, how good of you to come.
I heard you were up asking for me.
Oh, yes. Yes, as a matter of fact, it is something you could help me with. Here, you see, tomorrow evening there is to be a fancy dress costume ball at the Stenborgs, who live above us. And Torvald wants me to go as a Neapolitan fisher girl and dance the tarantella I learned at Capri.
I see you're going to keep up the character.
Yes, Torvald wants me to. But see, here's the dress. Torvald had it made for me there, but now it's also torn and
I can easily put this right. It's just some of the trimming has come unsewn here and there. Needle and thread. This is all we want.
That is nice of you.
So, Nora, you're going to dress up in a costume tomorrow night. I'll tell you what, I'll come up for a moment and see you in your fancy feathers. I almost forgot to thank you for the delightful evening yesterday.
I don't think yesterday was as pleasant as usual. You ought to have come into town earlier, Christine. Certainly, Torvald does know how to make a house look dainty and attractive.
And so do you. It seems to me you're not your father's daughter for nothing. Tell me something, Christine. Is Dr. Rank always as depressed as he was yesterday?
No. You see, I ought to tell you, he suffers from a dangerous disease. He has consumption of the spine, poor creature. Father committed all sorts of excesses, and that is why his son was sickly from childhood.
Nora, dear, how do you know anything about such things?
Who? When you have three children, you get visits from married women, and they talk about these things with one another.
Does Dr. Rand come here every day?
Oh, yes, every day. He is Torvald's most intimate friend, and a great friend of mine, too. He's just like one of the family here.
Yes. But is he perfectly sincere? Seems to me he's the kind of man who's very anxious to make himself agreeable.
Not in the least. What makes you think that?
Well, yesterday when you introduced us, he declared that my name was often heard in this house. But then I noticed that your husband hadn't the slightest idea of who I was. So then how could Dr. Rand...
Yes, that is quite right, Miss Deacon. You see, Torvald is so absurdly fond of me. He wants me all to himself, as he says. First, he used to almost seem jealous if I mentioned any of the dear folk at home, so naturally I gave up doing so. But I talk about these things with Dr. Rank because he likes hearing about them.
Listen to me, Nora. Oh, you're still so much like a child. And I'm much older than you are, and I have much more experience. So let me tell you something. I think you ought to make an end of it with Dr. Rank.
What ought I to make an end of?
Two things, I think. Yesterday, you were talking some nonsense about a rich admirer who was going to leave
you... An admirer who doesn't exist, unfortunately. What then?
Is Dr. Rank a man of means?
Yes, he is.
And he has nobody to provide for.
No one, but...
And he comes here every day.
Yes, I told you so.
How can this well-bred man be so tactless?
I don't understand you at all.
Stop pretending, Nora. You don't suppose I haven't guessed who lent you the $1,000?
Are you out of your senses? A friend of the family who comes here every day regularly? Do you realize what a horribly disagreeable position that would be?
Really, isn't he?
No, it never would have entered into my head to ask Dr. Rank. Besides, he didn't have the money to lend then.
Oh,
he came into his money afterwards.
I think that's a very lucky thing for you, Nora.
No, it never would have entered into my head to ask Dr. Rank. Although, I'm quite sure that if I asked him...
But of course you won't.
No, of course not. I have no reason to believe it could possibly be necessary. I'm quite sure that if I asked Dr.
Behind your husband's back?
Well, I must make an end of it with the other one, and that would be behind his back, too.
Yes, that's what I told you yesterday.
A man can put a thing like that straight much easier than a woman.
One's husband, yes.
When you pay off your debt, you get your bond back, don't you?
Yes, as a matter of course.
And you could tear it into 100,000 pieces, that dirty, nasty paper.
Nora. You're concealing something from me.
Do I look as if I were?
Something's happened to you since yesterday morning. What is it?
Hush, there's Torvald. Come home. Do you mind going into the children for the present? Torvald can't bear to see dressmaking going on.
Certainly. But I'm not going away from here until we have it out with one another.
Dressmaker?
Oh, no, that was Christine. She is just helping me to put my costume in order. Tomorrow, you will see, I shall look quite smart.
Oh, wasn't that a happy thought of mine just now?
Well, don't you think it was nice of me, too, to do as you wish?
Nice? To do what your husband wishes? Well, well, you little rogue, you. I'm sure you did not mean it in that way. But I will not be disturbing you. You will want to be trying on your costume, I expect.
I suppose you were going to work?
Yes. Just take a look at this. I've just been in the bank.
Torvald?
Yes?
If your little squirrel were to ask you something very, very prettily, would you
yes.
do it?
Well, I should be lucky to hear what it is first.
Well, your little squirrel would run about and do all her tricks if you be nice and do what she wants.
Speak plainly.
Your skylark would chirp about in every room with her song rising and falling.
Well, my skylark does that anyhow.
I'd play the fairy and dance for you in the moonlight, Torvald.
Oh, Nora, surely you don't mean that request you made of me this morning.
Yes, I beg you so earnestly.
Have you really the courage to bring up that question again?
Yes, you must do as I ask. You must let Crockston keep his post in the bank.
But Nora, it is his post that I arranged that Mrs. Lynn shall have.
Yes, and
Lynn, you have been awfully nice about that, but couldn't you just as well dismiss some other clerk instead of Krogstad?
This is simple, incredible obstinacy. Because you chose to give him a thoughtless promise, I am just expected
no,
to...
No, that isn't the reason. You know, this fellow writes in the most scurrilous newspapers. I am frightened to death of him.
I understand. It is recollections of the past that scare you.
What do you mean?
Well, naturally, you're thinking of your father.
Yes, yes. Just recall to mind what those malicious creatures wrote about him and, oh, how horribly they slandered him.
Nora, Nora, there is one important difference between your father and me. Your father's reputation was not above reproach. Mine is. And I would wish to continue to be so for as long as I hold my position.
Yes, but there's no telling what sort of mischief these men may contrive. And that's why I beg you so earnestly.
Nora, and it is just by interceding for him that you make it impossible for me to keep him. It is already known to the bank that I intend to dismiss Krogstad. Is it to get about now that the new manager has changed his mind at his wife's bidding?
What if it did?
Oh, of course! If only this obstinate little person can get her way. Do you suppose I am to make myself ridiculous before my whole staff and have people think that I'm a man to be swayed by all sorts of outside influences? I should very soon feel the consequences of that, let me tell you. Besides, there's one thing that makes it impossible for me to have Krogstad at the bank, as long as I am manager.
Well, whatever is that?
His moral failings I may perhaps have overlooked, if necessary.
Oh, yes, you could, couldn't you?
I hear he's a good worker. I knew him when we were boys. It was one of those rash friendships that one soon regrets in life. I might as well tell you plainly, Nora. He and I were once on very intimate terms with one another. But this tactless fellow lays no restraint upon himself in the presence of others, and so he thinks it perfectly gives him the right to adopt a familiar tone with me, and every minute it's, I say, Helmer, old fellow, and that sort of thing. I assure you, it is extremely painful. He would make my position in the bank intolerable.
Robert, I don't believe you mean that.
Don't you? Why not?
Because it is such a narrow-minded way of looking at things.
What? What did you say, narrow-minded?
Oh.
Do you think I'm narrow-minded?
No, no, just the opposite, dear. It is exactly the same
thing. No. It is exactly the same thing. You say that my point of view is narrow-minded, so therefore it must be so, too. Narrow-minded. Very well. I must put an end to this. Helen!
Well, what are you going to do?
Settle it. Take this letter and go downstairs with it at once. Find a messenger and have him deliver it and tell him to be quick. The address is on the envelope. Here is the money.
Very well, sir.
Well now, little Miss Obstinate.
What was that letter?
Krogstad's dismissal.
No, call her back. Call her back. There's still time. Call her back. Do it for your sake, for my sake, for the children's sake. Call her back.
It's too late. I can forgive the anxiety you're in, although it really is an insult to me. It truly is, indeed. Can't you see that it is an insult to me that I should be afraid of a starving quill driver's vengeance? But I forgive you nevertheless, because it is such eloquent witness to your great love for me. And that is how it should be. Come what may, you shall see that I have both courage and strength, if need be. You will find that I am man enough to take everything upon myself.
What do you mean by that?
Everything, I say.
You will never have to do that.
Well, you're right. I won't do it alone. We shall do it together, as husband and wife. That is how it shall be. Are you content now? Oh. There. Not those frightened dove eyes again. The whole thing is just the wildest fancy. Now, you must go and play through your tarantella and practice with your tambourine. I shall go into my inner office and shut the door, and I shall hear nothing. You can make as much noise as you please. Ah, and when Wright comes, tell him where he will find you.
Oh.
or some way out of it. Dr. Ray. Anything rather than that. Anything. Oh, good day, Dr. Ray. I knew your ring. But you mustn't go into Torvald now. I think he's busy with something.
Well, and you?
You know very well I always have time for you.
Well, thank you. I shall make use of as much of it as I can.
What do you mean, as much of it as you can?
Does that alarm you?
It's just a strange way of putting it. Is anything likely to happen?
Nothing but what I've been long prepared for, but I certainly didn't expect it to happen so soon.
What have you found out? You must tell me.
It is all up with me, and there's no helping me.
No, it's about yourself.
Of course. Who else? No use lying to oneself. I am the most wretched of my patients, Mrs. Helmer. Lately, I've been taking stock of my internal economy and bankrupt. Probably within a month, I shall lie rotting in the churchyard.
What an ugly thing to say.
The thing itself is cursedly ugly, but what's worse is I have to face so much more that is ugly before that. I shall make one more examination of myself. After that, I shall be pretty certain when it will be that the horrors of death will begin. I want to tell you something. Given Helmer's refined nature, he has an unconquerable disgust for anything that is ugly. I won't have him in my sick room. I won't have him there on any account. I bar my door to him. And I am pretty certain that the worst has come. I will send you my card with a black cross on it. Then you will know that the loathsome end has begun.
You are quite absurd today. And I had very much wanted you to be in good humor.
Well, with that stalking beside me, I mean, to pay this penalty for another man's sin? Where's the justice in that? And in every single family, in one way or another, some inexorable retribution is being enacted.
Rubbish, you told us something cheerful.
Oh, so this is a mere laughing matter to you? My poor innocent spine must suffer because of my father's youthful amusements?
I suppose you mean he was too partial to asparagus and foie gras, don't you?
Yes, and to truffles.
Yes, truffles. And oysters, too, I suppose.
Oysters? Of course. That goes without saying.
And heaps of port and champagne. It's a shame all of these nice things should take their revenge on our bones.
Especially that they should revenge themselves on the unlucky bones of those who never had the satisfaction of enjoying
them. That's the worst part. Why do you smile?
No, it was you that laughed.
No, it was you that smiled, Dr. Ray.
You are a greater rascal than I thought.
Well, I'm in a silly mood today.
So it seems.
Dear nice Dr. Rank, death mustn't take you from Torvald and me.
Well, it is a loss you will easily recover from. Those that are gone are soon forgotten.
Do you believe that?
Yes, people form new ties, then they
Who
go
Who will form new ties?
Both you and Helmer when I am gone. You yourself are already on the high road to it, I think. What did that Mrs. Lynde want here last night?
You don't mean to tell me you're jealous of poor Christine.
Yes, I am. She will be my successor in this house. That woman will...
She is in that room. Don't speak so loudly.
Again today. There, you see?
She has only come to sew my dress for me. Bless my soul, how unreasonable you are. Be nice now, Dr. Ray, and tomorrow you will see how beautifully I shall dance. And you can imagine I am doing it all for you. And Torvald too, of course.
Of course.
But come, sit here. I want to show you something.
What is it?
Just look at those.
Silk stockings?
Flesh-colored. Aren't they lovely? It's dark in here now. No, you must only look at the foot. All right, you may have a look at the leg, too, I suppose. Why do you look so critical, Dr. Ray? Don't you think they'll fit me?
Well, I have no means of forming an opinion on that.
For shame! That is to punish you.
All right, what are the nice things am I allowed to see?
Not a single thing more for being so naughty.
You know, sitting here talking to you as intimately as it is, I can't imagine what would have become of me if I had never come into this house.
I do believe you feel quite at home with us.
To be obliged to leave it all.
Nonsense, you are not going to leave.
And not leave behind even the slightest token of one's gratitude. Scarcely even a fleeting regret. Only an empty space that the first comer can fill as easily as anyone else.
If I asked you now for a... No.
What?
For a big proof of your friendship.
Yes, yes.
I mean a tremendously big favor.
Would you make me truly so happy for once?
Oh, but you don't know what it is yet.
No, but tell me.
No, I can't. I really can't. It is something out of all reason. It means advice and help and a favor.
Hey, the bigger the thing, the better. I can't conceive what it is you're talking about, but do tell me. Don't I have your confidence?
More than anyone else. You are my truest and best friend. So I will tell you what it is. It is something you must help me to prevent. You know how devotedly and inexpressibly deeply Torvald loves me. He would never hesitate for a moment to give his life for me.
Nora, you think he's the only one?
The only one?
The only one who would gladly give his life for your sake. I was determined that you should know before I went away, and there'll never be a better opportunity than this. Now, Nora, now you know. Now you know. You can trust me more than you can trust anyone else.
Let me pass.
Nora!
Helen! Bring in the lamp! That was really horrid of you.
To love you as much as anyone else does was horrid?
No, but to go and tell me so, there really was no need.
What do you mean? Did you know, Nora? Mrs. Helmer, tell me, had you any idea of this?
How do I know whether I had or hadn't? I really can't tell you. To think you could be so clumsy, Dr. Rank. We were getting on so nicely.
Well, in all events, now you know. You command me, body and soul. So won't you speak out?
After what happened?
I beg of you, tell me what it is.
I can't tell you anything now.
No, yes, yes, don't punish me like this. Give me permission to do for you whatever a man can do.
You can do nothing for me now. Besides, you will find that this whole thing was really just a fancy on my part. It really was. Of course it was. Dear nice Dr. Rank, don't you feel ashamed now that the light has come?
Not a bit. Perhaps I should go forever?
No, you must come and sit here just as before. You know very well, Torvald can't get along a bit without you.
Yes, but you.
I am always tremendously pleased when you come.
You see, it is just that that puts me off track. You are real to me. At times I think that you almost would rather be in my company as Helmer's.
Yes, you see, there are some people one loves best, and others whom one would almost always rather have as companions.
Yes, there is something in that.
But I was at home. Of course I loved Papa best, but I always thought it great fun if I could steal into the maid's room because they talked about such entertaining things and they never moralized at all.
I see. So it's their place I've taken, huh?
Oh, no, Dr. Rick, I never meant that at all. But surely you can see that being with Torvald is a bit like being with Papa.
If you please, ma'am.
Oh.
Is anything wrong?
No, it is just something. It is my new dress.
It would be your dress is in here.
Yes, that one. But this is another one. I ordered it, and Torvald mustn't know anything about it.
Oh, so that was the great secret.
Yes. Just go into him now, and please keep him as long as you can.
Don't worry yourself. I won't let him escape.
Until he has seen you.
Very well. Tell him to come in, but quietly. And Helen, don't tell anyone about this. It is a surprise for my husband.
I quite understand that.
Dreadful thing is going to happen. No. It can't happen. Shed. Speak low. My husband is at home.
No matter about that.
Well, what do you want?
An explanation of something.
Make haste, then. What is it?
You know, I suppose, that I have got my dismissal.
I couldn't prevent it, Mr. Crockston. I fought as hard as I could on your side.
Does your husband love you so little? He knows what I can expose you to, and yet he...
How can you suppose he has any knowledge of the sort?
I didn't suppose so at all. It would not be at all like our dear Torvald Helmer to show so much courage.
Mr. Crockston, a little respect for my husband, please.
Certainly. All the respect he deserves. But since you kept the matter so carefully to yourself, I make bold to suppose you have a little clearer understanding than you had yesterday of what it actually is you've done.
More than you could ever teach me.
Yes. Such a bad lawyer as I am.
What do you want?
I want to see how you were. I've thought about you all day. A mere cashier, a quill driver. Well, a man like myself. Even he has a little of what is called feeling.
Show it, then. Think of my children.
Your husband thought of mine. But never mind that. I just wanted to tell you that you needn't take the whole matter too seriously. In the first place, there will be no accusations made on my part.
Of course not. I was sure of that.
It can all be arranged amicably. No one need know anything about it. It can remain a secret between us three.
My husband must never get to know anything about it.
How will you be able to prevent it? Am I to understand that you can pay the balance that is owing?
Well, not just at the present.
Or perhaps that you have some expedient for raising the money soon.
No expedient I mean to make use of.
In any case, it would have done you no good. Even if you stood there with ever so much money in your hand, I should never part with your bond.
Tell me what purpose you mean to put it to.
Merely preserve it. Keep it in my possession. No one not concerned in the matter need have any hint of it. So if the thought of it had driven you to any desperate resolutions...
It has.
You had it in your mind to run away from your home.
I had.
Or even something worse.
How did you know that?
Give up the idea.
How did you know I had thought of that?
Most of us think about it first, Mrs. Helmer. I did too. But I haven't the courage.
No more had I.
That's it then. You haven't the courage either?
I haven't.
It would have been a great piece of fun. But once the first storm at home is over, I have a letter for your husband in my pocket.
Telling him everything?
In as lenient a manner as I possibly could.
No, tear it up. He mustn't get the letter. I will find some means of getting the money to you.
Excuse me, Mrs. Helmer, but I think I told you.
I am not speaking of what I owe you. Tell me what sum you are asking my husband for, and I will get you that money.
I'm not asking your husband for a penny.
What do you want, then?
I will tell you. I want to rehabilitate myself, Mrs. Helmer. I want to get on. And in that, your husband must help me. For the last year and a half, I have not had a hand in anything dishonorable. In all that time, I have struggled under the most restricted circumstances. I was content to work my way up, step by step. But now I am turned out, and I will not be satisfied with merely being taken back into favor. I want to get on, I tell you. I want to get back into the bank, in a higher position. Your husband must make a place for me.
That he will never do.
He will. I know him. He dare not protest. Once I am back in there with him, then you will see. In a year, I will be the manager's right hand. It will be Nils Krogstad and not Torvald Helmer who manages the bank.
That's a thing you will never see.
Do you mean that you'll go through?
I have courage enough right now.
Can't frighten me, a fine, spoiled lady like yourself.
You will see. You will see.
Under the ice, perhaps? Down into the cold, cold black water. And then in the spring to float back up, all horrible and unrecognizable, with your hair falling out.
But you can't frighten me.
Nor you me. People don't do such things, Mrs. Helmer. Yes, I totally be the use. I should have him completely in my power all the same.
Afterwards, even when I am no longer...
Ah, but you forget. It is I who have the keeping of your reputation. Well, now I've warned you. Don't do anything foolish. When your husband has had my letter, I will expect a message from him. be sure you remember. It is your husband himself who has forced me into ways such as this again. I will never forgive him. Goodbye, Mrs. Hunter.
Going? He's not putting it in the letterbox. What? Oh. There it lies. There's no hope for us now, Torvald.
There now. I can't find anything else to mend. Would you like to try it on?
Christine, come here.
What's the matter with you? You look so agitated.
Do you see that letter? There it is, lying in the letterbox. You can see it through the glass.
Yes, I see it.
That letter is from Krogstad.
Nora, it was Krogstad who lent you the money.
Yes, and now Torvald will know all about it.
Oh, Nora, that would be the best thing for both of you.
You don't know all. I forged a name.
Good heavens.
I only want to say this to you, Christine. You must be my witness.
Witness? What do you mean? What am I to witness?
If I should go out of my mind, and it might easily happen.
Oh,
or if anything else might happen that would prevent my being here.
Oh, Nora, you're quite out of your mind.
If it were to happen that someone else wanted to take all of the blame, all of the responsibility, do you understand?
Yes. Yes, but
then
but
you must be my witness that it is not true. I am not out of my mind at all. I am in my right senses now, and I tell you that I, and I alone, have done this whole thing. Remember that.
I will, but I don't understand any of this.
There's no need you should. A wonderful thing is going to happen.
A wonderful thing?
Yes, a wonderful thing. But it is so terrible, it mustn't happen for all of the world.
I'm going to go and talk to Krogstad right away.
No, no. Don't do that. He will only do you some harm.
No, there was a time he would have gladly done anything on my behalf.
He?
Where does he live?
How should I? Oh, yes, here's his card. His card. Yes, but the letter, it is all ready.
All right.
Yes? Yes, what is it?
Oh, don't sound so frightened, my darling. We're not coming in. You're locked the door. Are you trying on your costume?
Yes, yes, that's it. I look so nice.
I see he lives right here at the corner.
Yes, but it's no use. The letter's already lying in the letterbox.
Does your husband have the key?
Yes, always.
Well, then, Krogstad will have to ask for the letter back unread. He'll have to think of some pretense.
Yes, but it is just at this time that
trouble... You must delay him. Go in the meantime. I will... be back as soon as I can.
Torvald?
Oh, well now, may I finally venture into my own room again? Come along, Rick. Now you shall see. What is this?
What is what, dear?
Frank led me to expect a splendid transformation.
I understood so, but evidently I was mistaken.
No one is to have the chance of admiring me in my costume until tomorrow.
My darling, you look so worn out. Have you been practicing too much?
No, I haven't practiced at all.
But you will need to.
Yes, I will need to, but I can't get along a bit without your help. I've completely forgotten the whole thing.
Oh, we shall manage to work it out.
Yes, help me. I am so nervous about it, all of the people. You must devote yourself entirely to me this evening. Not the tiniest bit of business at all. Promise me that, Torvald.
I promise. This evening I shall be wholly and absolutely at your service. You helpless little mortal. Oh, but first of all, let me just check.
What are you going to do there?
Oh, seeing if any letters have arrived.
No. Don't do that.
Why not?
I don't. There is nothing there.
Well, let me look. Aha!
me to do.
Now play for me, and I will dance.
Slower!
This is the way!
Not so violently, Nora!
I can't do it any other way!
No, that does not fit right!
Didn't I tell you so?
Let me play for her.
Yes, do, then I can correct her better. Child shall have her way. But tomorrow evening, after you have danced.
Then you will be free.
Excuse me, ma'am. Dinners.
We'll have champagne, Helen.
Yes, ma'am.
Hello, are we going to have a banquet?
Yes, yes. A champagne banquet until the early hours. And a few macaroons, Helen. Lots, but just for this once.
Come, don't be so wild and nervous. I'll be my own little skylark, just as you used to.
I will. But go in now. And you too, Dr. Rank. Christine, you must help me to do up my hair.
I suppose there is nothing. She's not expecting anything.
Far from it. Simply nothing more than this childish and nervous since I was coming to you.
Well,
gone out of town.
I can tell from your face.
Well, he'll be back tomorrow evening. I left him a note.
You shouldn't have. You must prevent nothing. After all, it is splendid to be waiting for a wonderful thing to happen.
What is it that you're waiting for?
You wouldn't understand. Go in now, and I will be in a moment. Why, Flock? 7 hours until midnight. 4:20 until the next midnight. And then the tarantella will be over. 4 and 7. 31 hours to live.
Where's my little skylark?
Here she is!
Should be here.
Well, it's impossible where I live. My rooms have no private entrance. We are quite alone. The maid is downstairs and the Helmers are at a dance upstairs.
Are the Helmers really at a dance tonight?
Yes. Why not?
Certainly. Why not?
Now, Nils, let's have a talk.
Can we two have anything to talk about?
We have a great deal to talk about.
I shouldn't have thought so.
No, you've never properly understood me.
What was there to understand except what was clear to the whole world? A heartless woman jilts a man when a more lucrative chance turns up.
Do you really think I'm as heartless as all that? And do you think I did it with a light heart?
Didn't you?
Mills, did you really think that?
Well, if it's as you say, why did you write me as you did at the time?
I could do nothing else. I knew I had to break with you. And I thought it was my duty to put an end to all that you felt for me.
So that's it. And all this only for the sake of money.
Don't forget I had a helpless mother and two little brothers. Prospects were hopeless then.
Maybe so. But you had no right to throw me over for anybody else's sake.
Indeed. I don't know. I've asked myself many times if I have the right to do it.
When I lost you, as if all the solid ground went from under my feet. Look at me now. I'm a shipwrecked man, clinging to a bit of wreckage.
Help may be near.
Help was near. But then you came and stood in my way.
Unintentionally. It was only today that I learned it was your place at the bank I was going to take.
I believe you. If you say it is so. But now that you know why, you're not going to give it up to me.
No. Because it wouldn't benefit you in the least.
Benefit? I would have done it whether or no.
I've had to learn to act prudently. Life and hard, bitter necessity have taught me that.
And life has taught me not to believe in fine speeches.
Life has taught you something very reasonable. But deeds, you must believe in.
What do you mean by that?
You say that you're like a shipwrecked man clinging to some wreckage?
I had good reason to say so.
I am like a shipwrecked woman clinging to some wreckage. Nobody to mourn for, nobody to care for.
It was your own choice?
It was the only choice then.
Well, what now?
What would you say, Mills, if two shipwrecked people could join forces?
What do you say?
Two on the same piece of wreckage would stand a better chance than one and the other on their own piece.
Christine,
you know why I came to this town.
Do you mean you gave me a thought?
I can't endure my life without any work. All my life I've worked, as long as I can remember, and it's my greatest and only pleasure. And now I'm completely alone in this world. My life is so unspeakably empty. I feel so forsaken. Mills, give me someone and something to work for.
I don't trust that. It is nothing more than a woman's overstrained sense of generosity which prompts you to make such a fool of yourself.
Have you ever known anything of that sort in me?
Could you really do it? Tell me, do you know all about my past life?
Yes.
And do you know what they think of me here?
You seem to imply that with me you might have been quite a different man.
I'm certain of it.
Well, is it too late now?
You're saying these things deliberately?
Yes.
I'm sure you are. I see it in your face. Have you really the courage?
I want to be a mother to someone. And your children need a mother. We need I believe in your real character. I can dare anything together with you.
Thank you. Thank you, Christine. Now I will find a way to clear my...
Shh! Tarantella, you must go.
Why, what is it?
Do you hear that upstairs? When that's over, they'll be back.
Yes, I will go. It's all no use. Of course, you're not aware of the steps I've taken in the matter of the Helmers.
Yes, I know all about it.
And in spite of that, you have the courage to...
Know very well to what lengths a man like you might be driven by despair.
If only I could undo what I've done.
Well, you cannot. Your letter is in the letterbox now.
Are you sure of that?
Quite sure.
what this all means? That you want to save your friend at any cost? Tell me frankly, is that it?
Yes. A woman who has once sold herself for the sake of another doesn't do it a second time.
I'll ask for my letter back.
No.
Yes, yes, of course. When Helmer comes down, I'll tell him I must have my letter back. That it concerns my dismissal.
That no, you must not recall your letter.
But wasn't it for that very purpose that you asked me to meet you
yes.
here?
Yes. In the first moment of fright, it was. But 24 hours have passed since then, and in that time, I have witnessed incredible things in this house. Helmer must know all about it. This unhappy secret must be revealed. There must be a complete understanding between them. And there can't be with all this concealment and in this falsehood going on.
Very well. If you will take the responsibility. But there is one thing I can do,
yes,
and that I
must
shall do
go
at
quickly.
Once.
The dance is over. We're not safe a moment longer.
I will wait for you below.
Yes. You must walk me to my door.
I have never had such an incredible piece of good fortune.
Home to bring comfort to, that I will do. Oh, I wish they'd hurry and come back. Okay. I'll put on my things.
No, no, don't take me. And I want to go upstairs again. I don't want to leave so early.
Oh, my darling, Nora.
Please, Coco, dear, please, only an hour more.
Not a minute longer, my sweet Nora. That was our agreement. Now, come along into the room. You're catching cold standing out there.
Good evening.
You here?
Oh.
Sweetly, Mrs. Lynn.
Excuse me. I was so anxious to see Nora in her costume.
Have you been sitting here waiting for me?
Yes. Unfortunately, I came too late and you'd already gone upstairs. I didn't think I could leave without having seen you.
Ah, yes. Take a good look at her. I think she's worth looking at. Isn't she charming, Mrs. Lynn?
Yes.
Isn't she remarkably pretty?
Yes, she is.
Everyone at the dance thought so. But the sweet little person is so terribly self-willed. Would you believe I almost had to bring her away by force?
You will repent not having let me stay, even if it were only for half an hour.
Oh, listen to her, Mrs. Lynn. She had danced the Tarantella to tremendous success, as it well deserved. Although the performance was a trifle too realistic. I mean, a little more so than was strictly compatible within the limits of art, but never mind about that. She had made a success. She had made a tremendous success. Do you think I was going to let her remain there and spoil the effect? No, indeed. I took my little Capri maiden, my capricious little Capri maiden, I should say, on my arm, took one quick turn around the room, a curtsy on either side, and as they say in novels, the beautiful apparition disappeared. An exit ought always to be effective, don't you think, Mrs. Lynn? But that is not what I can get our sweet Nora to understand. Whew, this room is hot. Hello, it's all dark in here. Oh, yes, of course, excuse me.
Well, spoken to in.
Yes, Anne?
Nora, you must tell your husband all about it.
I knew it.
You have nothing more to fear from Krogstad, but you must tell your husband.
I won't tell him.
Then your letter will.
Thank you, Christine. Now I know what it is I must do.
There now, have you admired her, Mrs. Lynn?
Yes, I think I will say good night.
What, already? Oh, is that yours, that knitting?
Oh, yes, thank you.
Ah, so you knit?
Of course.
Well, you know you really ought to embroider.
Really? Why?
Well, here, let me show you. Here. Now, you hold the embroidery thus with your left hand and with the right. Watch me, you make a long, sweeping stroke like this, do you see?
Yes.
But in the case of knitting, it can never be anything more than ungraceful. Now see here, the arms close together, the knitting needles going up and down,
has sort of a Chinese effect. Oh, that was really excellent champagne they gave us.
Well, good night, Nora. Don't be self-willed anymore.
Ah, that's right, Mrs. Lin.
Good night, Mr. Helmer.
Oh, good night, good night. I should hope you would get home all right. I should be very happy to... you and I made great business ago. Good night! At last we have gotten rid of her. That woman is a frightful bore.
Aren't you very tired, Torvald?
Not in the least.
Nor sleepy?
Oh, on the contrary, I feel extraordinarily lively. And you? You look both very tired and sleepy, my dear.
Yes, I am very tired. I want to go to sleep at once.
Ah, you see, it was quite right of me not to let you stay there any longer.
Everything you do is quite right, Torvald.
Now my little Skylark is speaking reasonably. Did you notice what good spirits Rank was in this evening?
Really, I didn't speak with him at all.
And I very little, but I have not for the longest time seen him in such good form. It is splendid that we can be at home together. Together with you, you fascinating, charming little darling.
Don't look at me like that, Torvald!
Oh, I shouldn't I look at my greatest treasure? All that beauty that is mine, all my very own.
You mustn't say things like that to me tonight, Torvald.
You have still got the Tarantella in your blood, I see. It makes you more captivating than ever. Listen, I guess we're beginning to leave. Laura, soon the whole house will be quiet.
I hope so.
Do you know why I am out at a party with you like this? Why I say so little to you and keep my distance from you and only send you a stolen glance every now and then? You know why I do that? Mm. It's because I make believe to myself that we are secretly in love. And that you are my secretly promised bride and that no one suspects there is anything between us.
Yes, I know very well your thoughts are with me all of the time.
Oh, all the time, my darling. And when we are leaving, and I am putting that shawl over your lovely young shoulders and your beautiful neck, it is then that I imagine that you are my young bride, and that we have just returned from the wedding, and that I am taking you for the very first time to be in my home. To be all alone with you, you shy little darling. Well, this evening I have wanted. When I saw the seductive figures of the Tarantella, my blood was on fire. I couldn't take it any longer, and that is why I had to get you downstairs right away.
Go away, Torvald. You must let me go. I won't.
What? Nora, you must be joking. You won't. You won't? Am I not your husband?
Did you hear?
Oh, who is it?
It is I. Can I come in for a moment?
What does he want now? Hold on. Come. It was so kind of you to not pass by our door.
Yeah, I thought I heard your voice and I felt I might come in for a moment and... Oh, yes, these dear familiar rooms. You are very happy and cozy here, you two.
Oh, well, it seems to me that you took rather good care of yourself upstairs, too.
Excellently. And why shouldn't I? Why shouldn't one enjoy everything in this world at any rate as much as one can for as long as one can? Ooh, the wine was capital.
Yes, and especially the champagne.
Oh, you noticed that too? Yeah, it's almost incredible how much I managed to put away.
Torvald drank a great deal of champagne tonight, too.
Oh, did he?
And he's always in such good spirits afterwards.
Well, why shouldn't one be one in good spirits after a well-spent day?
Well spent? Well, I'm afraid I can't take credit for that.
Well, but I can, you know.
Dr. Rank, you must have been occupied with some scientific investigation.
Exactly.
Listen to that. Little Nora speaking of scientific investigation.
And may I congratulate you on the result?
Indeed you may.
Is it favorable, then?
The most favorable for doctor and patient. Certainty.
Certainty?
Absolute certainty. And wasn't I entitled to make a merry evening and after that?
You certainly were.
Yes, I think so too, so long as you don't have to pay for it.
My dear fellow, you can't have anything in this world without paying for it.
Dr. Rank, are you fond of fancy costume balls?
Oh, yes, it is a fine lot of pretty costumes.
Tell me, what shall we two wear to the next?
Little feather brain, are you thinking of the next already?
We two? Yes, I will tell you. You shall go dressed as a good fairy.
Ah, yes, but what do you suggest as an appropriate costume for that?
Let your wife go dressed just as she does in everyday life.
That was really very prettily timed. But now, won't you tell us what you shall be?
Oh, yes, I have quite made up my mind about that.
Well?
At the next fancy dress ball, I will be invisible.
That's a good joke.
There's this big black hat. Have you never heard of hats that make one invisible? You put it on and no one can see you.
Yes, you are quite right.
Oh, I'm forgetting what I came for. Helmer, give me a cigar.
Ah, with great pleasure.
One of the dark Havanas.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Thank you. Well, now, goodbye.
Ah, goodbye. Goodbye, dear old friend.
Sleep well, Dr. Rank.
Thank you for that wish.
Wish me the same.
You? Well, if you want me to sleep well. Thank you for the cigar.
What are you going to do there?
Yeah, only empty the letterbox. It is quite full, and there will be no room for the morning paper.
Are you going to work tonight?
Well, quite well, I'm not going to do that. What is this? Someone has been at the lock.
At the lock?
Yes, someone has. What can you mean? I should hardly think that's a name. There's a broken hairpin. It is one of yours.
Then it must have been the children.
Well, you must get them out of those ways. There, at last they've got it open. Helen, Helen, put out the light over the front door. Look at that. Look what a heap of them there are. What on earth is that?
Torvald,
two cards of Ranks.
Dr. Ranks.
The Rank. They were on the top. You must have put them in when you went out.
Has anything written on them?
There's a black cross over his name. See here. What an uncomfortable idea. It's as if he were announcing his own death.
That is just what he's doing.
What? Do you know anything about this? Has he said anything to you?
He told me that when the guards came, it would be his leave-taking from us. He means to shut himself up and die.
Old friend, I should not have thought he'd be with us so very long, but so soon. So he hides himself away like a wounded animal.
If it has to happen, it is best it should be without word, isn't it, Torvald?
It's so grown into our lives, I can hardly think of him being out of that. He with his sufferings and loneliness was like a cloudy background to our sunny happiness. Perhaps it is better this way. For him, anyway. Perhaps for us, too. Yeah. We two are quite thrown upon each other now. I don't feel as if I could hold you tighter. You know that I have often wished that you would be in some terrible danger so that I might risk my life's blood and everything for your sake.
Now you must read your letters.
Oh, no, not tonight. I want to be with you, my darling wife.
With the thought of your friend's death.
Yes, you are right.
has affected us both. Something ugly has come between us. The horrors of the thoughts of death. We must try and rid our minds of that. Till then, shall each go to our own world.
Good night, Torvald. Good night.
Good night, my little singing bird. Sleep sound, Nora. Now, I shall read my letters through.
Never see him again. Never see my children again either. Icy black waters, the unfathomable depths. Goodbye, Torvald. Goodbye, my children.
Nora, what is this? You know what is in this letter?
Yes, I know. Let me go. You must let me go.
Where are you going?
You shan't save me, Torvald.
Oh, don't let us have any silly excuses.
Torvald!
Miserable creature, what have you done?
You shall not suffer for my sake. You shall not take it upon yourself.
Oh, no tragic airs, please. Now, here you shall stay and give me an explanation. Do you understand what you have done? Answer me! Do you understand what you have done?
Yes, I am beginning to understand it thoroughly now.
What a horrible awakening. She, who for 8 years was my joy and pride, a liar, a hypocrite, and worse, a criminal. The unutterable ugliness of it all. For shame. For shame. I should have suspected something like this would happen. I should have foreseen it all along. All your father's lack of principle has come out in you. No religion, no morality, no sense of duty. How am I being punished for having winked at what he did? I did it all for your sake, Nora. This is how you repay me?
Yes, that's just it.
How you have completely destroyed my happiness. You have ruined all my future. I am in the mercy of an unscrupulous man. He can do anything he likes of me, ask anything he likes of me, give me any order he pleases, I dare not refuse him. I must sink to such miserable depths because of a thoughtless woman.
When I am out of the way, you will be free.
Oh, no fine speeches, please. Your father always had plenty of those. Besides, what good would it do me if you were out of the way, as you say? None in the slightest. Horrible thought. He can make the affair known everywhere, and if he does, I may be very likely suspected of having been a party to your criminal action. People will suspect that I was behind it all, or even that I prompted you to do it. And I have you to thank for this. You, whom I have loved and cherished for the whole of our entire married life. Do you understand now what you have done to me?
Yes.
It's just so incredible, I cannot take it in. We must come to some understanding about this. Take off that shawl. Take it off, I tell you. I must try and appease him. That's some way or another. The whole matter must be hushed up at any cost. And as for you and me, everything shall be just as it was before. Naturally, only in the eyes of the world. You shall remain in my house. That is a matter of course. I will not allow you to bring up the children. I dare not trust them to you. And to think that I should be so obliged to say so to someone whom I have loved so dearly, and whom I still... Now, it's over. Now, from this moment on, happiness is out of the question. The only thing that concerns us now is saving the remains, the fragments, the appearance. Is that so late? For the worst, hide yourself. Oh. You are. Say you are ill.
A letter for the mistress.
Give it to me. Yes, it is from him. You shall not have it. I will read it myself.
Yes, read it.
You scarcely have the courage to do this. It's going to be the ruin for both of us. I must know. Laura. No, wait. I must read this to you again. Yes, it is true. I am saved. Nora, I am saved.
And I?
Yes, you too. You too are saved. We are both saved.
You see here, look. He sends you your bond back. He says a happy arrangement in his life. Who cares what it says? Nora, we are saved. No one can do anything to you now. Oh, Nora, Nora. Now, first I must destroy these hateful things. Come on, look. The whole thing, nothing more than a bad dream to me. Christmas Eve, you... These have been three dreadful days for you, Nora.
I have fought hard these 3 days.
I've suffered agonies and seen no way out, but... Nothing. We shall not dwell on these horrible thoughts anymore. We shall only shout for joy and keep repeating, it is all over! Do you hear me? It is all over! Seem to understand that it is all over. What is this? This cold, set face? I understand. You could not feel that it is possible that I have forgiven you. But it is true. I swear to it, Nora. I have forgiven you everything. I know that what you did out of love for me.
Yes, that is true.
You have loved me as a wife ought to love her husband, although you had not the knowledge to judge of the means by which you used, but do you suppose that makes you any less dear to me? Because you can't understand how to act on your own responsibility? No, no. Only lean on me and I will advise and direct you. I should not be a man if this womanly helplessness did not just give you a double attractiveness in my eyes. You mustn't think any more on the hard things that I said before, in my moment of consternation when I thought that everything was going to overwhelm me. I have forgiven you, Nora. I swear to it, I have forgiven you.
Thank you for your forgiveness.
No, don't go. What are you doing in there?
Taking off my costume.
Ah, yes, do. Try and calm yourself down and make your mind easy again, my scared little singing bird. Be at rest and feel secure. I have broad wings to shelter you under. How warm and cozy our home is, Nora. Here is shelter for you. Here you shall find rest. I will rescue you like a hunted dove that I have saved from a hawk's claws. I will calm your poor beating heart. It will come, Nora, little by little you shall see. Tomorrow morning you shall look upon things quite differently. Soon everything will be just as it was before. Very soon you will not need me to assure you that I have forgiven you. You yourself will feel the certainty of my having done so. Do you suppose that I should ever think to repudiate or even reproach you? Oh, Nora. You have no idea what a true man's heart is like. There is something so indescribably sweet and satisfying to a man in the knowledge that he has forgiven his wife, and that he has forgiven her completely and with all his heart. It is as if she has become, as it were, doubly his own. What is this knock on the bed? Have you changed your things?
Yes, Torvald. I've changed my things now.
Well, what for? It's so late.
I shall not sleep tonight.
But my darling Nora!
It is not so very late. Sit down here, Torvald. You and I have much to say to one another.
Nora, what is with this cold, hard face?
Sit down. It will take some time, and I have much to talk over with you.
You alarm me, Nora, and I don't understand you.
No, that's just it. You have never understood me.
And I have never understood you either until tonight.
Nora.
You mustn't interrupt me. You must simply listen to what it is I have to say. Torvald, this is a settling of accounts.
What do you mean by that?
Is there any one thing that strikes you as strange in our sitting here like this?
What is that?
We have been married 8 years now. Does it not occur to you that this is the first time we two, you and I, husband and wife, have ever had a serious conversation?
What do you mean by serious?
In all of these 8 years, longer than that, from the very beginning of our acquaintance, we have never exchanged a word on a serious subject.
Was it likely that I would be continually and forever burdening you with worries that you could not help me to bear?
I am not speaking of business matters. I say that we two have never sat down in earnest together and gotten to the bottom of anything.
Oh, my darling Nora, would it have done you any good?
That's just it. You have never understood me. I have been greatly wronged, Torvald, first by Papa and then by you.
What? By us two? By us two who have loved you better than anyone else in this world?
You have never loved me. You have only thought it would be pleasant to be in love with me.
Nora, what do I hear you saying?
It is perfectly true. When I was at home with Papa, he told me his opinions on everything, and so I got the same opinions. And if I differed from him, I concealed that fact because he would not have liked it. He called me his doll child, and he played with me just as I used to play with my dolls. And then when I came to live with you...
What sort of an expression is that to use about our marriage?
It's as if I was simply transferred from Papa's hands into yours. You arranged everything here according to your own taste, and so I got the same taste as you. Thus I pretended to, really not quite sure which. I think sometimes one and sometimes the other. It's as if I've been living here like a poor woman from hand to mouth. I had existed merely to perform tricks for you, but you would have it so. You and Papa have committed a great sin against me. It is your fault I have made nothing of my life.
How unreasonable and how ungrateful you are! Have you not been happy here?
I've never been happy. I thought I was, but I really was not so.
Not happy?
No. Only married. And our home has been nothing but a playroom. Here I have been your doll wife, and the children have been my dolls. I thought it great fun when you played with me, just as they thought it great fun when I played with them. That is all our marriage has been, Torvald.
There is some truth in what you say, as exaggerated and strange as your view of it is, but in the future, things shall be different. From now on, playtime shall be over, lesson time shall begin.
Whose lessons? Mine or the children's?
Both yours and the children's, my darling Nora.
Alas, Torvald, you are not the man to educate me into being a proper wife for you.
And you can say that?
And I? How am I fitted to bring up the children?
Nora!
Didn't you say so yourself just a little while ago? You dare not trust me to bring them up?
Oh, in a moment of anger, why do you pay any heed to that?
Indeed, you are perfectly true. I am not fit for the task. There is another task I must undertake first. I must try and educate myself, and you are not the man to help me with that. And that is why I am going to leave you now.
What do you say?
I must stand quite alone if I am to understand myself and everything about me. And that is why I will not stay here any longer.
Nora! Nora!
I'm going to leave you now, and I am sure Christine will take me in for the night.
You are out of your mind. I won't allow it. I forbid you.
I will take nothing that belongs to you, either now or later. I will take only things that I brought from my own home.
What sort of madness is this?
Tomorrow I will go to my old home. It will be easiest for me to find something there.
Blind, foolish woman!
I must try and get some sense, Torvald.
To forsake your home, your husband, and your children? And you do not consider what people will say.
I cannot consider that at all. I only know what is necessary for me.
Necessary to neglect your most sacred duties.
What do you consider my most sacred duties?
Do I need to tell you what they are? Are they not duties to your husband and your children?
I have other duties just as sacred.
But you have not. What duties could those be?
Duties to myself.
For all else, you are a wife and a mother.
I don't believe it any longer. I believe that before all else, I am a reasonable human being. Else I must try and become one. I know that most people would think you are right, and that views of that kind are found in books, but I cannot content myself any longer with what most people think and with what is found in books. I must think things over and try and understand them for myself.
Understand? Have you no understanding of your roles in your own home? Have you no reliable guide in matters such as that? Have you no religion?
I'm afraid, Torvald, I don't know what religion is.
What are you saying?
Only what the clergyman told me when I went to be confirmed. When I am away from all of this and alone, I will think on that matter too and decide if what the clergyman said was true, or if at all events it is true for me.
This is unheard of in a girl your age. But if religion cannot set you astray, let me try and awaken your conscience in you. I suppose you have some moral sense about you. Answer me this. Why do you think you have none?
I assure you, Torvald, not an easy question to answer. I only know that you and I look at it in quite a different light. And I am learning that the law, too, is quite a different thing than what I supposed. According to it, a daughter is not allowed to spare her dying father anxiety and care, and a wife is not allowed to save her husband's life. I can't believe that.
You think like a child. You have no understanding of the conditions of the world in which you live.
Maybe. But I need to figure out who is right, the world or
you are ill, Nora. You are delirious. I almost think you're out of your mind.
I have never felt so clear and certain in my mind as tonight.
It is with a clear and certain mind that you forsake your husband and your children?
Yes.
So there is only one possible explanation for this.
Whatever is that?
Me anymore.
Yes, that is true.
Nora, and you can say that?
It gives me great pain, for you have always been so kind to me, but I cannot help it. I do not love you any longer.
Is that a clear and certain conviction, too?
Yes. Absolutely clear and certain, and that is why I will not stay here any longer.
Can you tell me what I have done to forfeit your love?
Yes. Yes, indeed I can. It was tonight, when the wonderful thing did not happen, and that I saw you were not the man I thought you were.
Explain yourself better. I don't understand you.
I waited patiently for 8 years. For goodness knows, wonderful things don't happen every day. And this horrible misfortune came upon me. Absolutely certain the wonderful thing was going to happen at last. When Krogstad's letter was lying out there, never for a moment did I imagine you would consent to accept that man's conditions. I was absolutely certain you would say to him, publish the whole thing, and then when that was done...
Yes, and when that had happened and I had exposed my wife to shame and disgrace?
When that was done, I was absolutely certain you would come forward and say, I am the guilty one.
Nora!
Oh, what? I would not have accepted such a sacrifice on your part. No, of course not. But what would my assurances have been against yours? That was the wonderful thing which I had hoped for and feared, and it was to prevent that that I wanted to kill myself.
I would gladly work night and day for you, Nora. I would bear sorrow and want for your sake. No man would sacrifice his honor for the one he loves.
It is a thing hundreds of thousands of women have done.
Ah, you think and talk like a heedless child.
Maybe. But you neither think nor talk like the man I could bind myself to. As soon as your fear was over, and it was not fear for what threatened me, but for what might happen to you. As soon as your fear was over, it was exactly as if nothing had happened. I was your little skylark, your doll, which in future you would treat with doubly gentle care, because she was so brittle and fragile. Torvald, it was then it
dawned upon me that for 8 years I have been living here with a stranger and have borne him 3 children. I can't bear to think of it. I could tear myself to bits.
I see. I see. This is open between us. There's no denying it. Nora, wouldn't it not be possible to fill it up again?
As I am now, I am no wife for you.
I have it in me to become a different man.
Maybe, if your doll is taken from you.
But to part from you, Nora, no, I can't understand that idea.
That makes it all the more certain it must be done.
No, wait, not tonight. No, wait until tomorrow.
I cannot spend the night in a strange man's room.
Can we live here as brother and sister?
Oh, you know very well that would not last long. Goodbye, Torvald. I will not see the little ones. I know they are in better hands than my own. As I am now, I am of no use to them.
Someday, Laura. Someday.
Oh, I know. I have no idea what is to become of me.
My wife never becomes of you.
Listen, Torvald. I have heard that when a wife deserts her husband, as I am doing now, she is legally free from all obligations toward her. In any case, I free you from all obligations. You are not to feel yourself bound in the slightest. There must be perfect freedom on both sides. Here. Here is your ring back. Give me mine.
That too?
Yes, that too. There. Now it is done. The maids know everything about the house even better than I do, and tomorrow after I've left her, Christine will come and pack my own things that I brought from my own home.
Over. All over. Narna, shall you never think of me again?
I know I shall think of you often. Of the children, and of this house.
May I write to you, Nora?
No. You must never do that.
But let me send you something. Some money, something. Anything.
Nothing.
Let me help you if you are in want.
No, I can receive nothing from a stranger.
Nora. I'll never be anything more but a stranger to you.
The most wonderful thing of all would have to happen.
Tell me what? What is that?
Both you and I would have to be so changed that... Torvald, I don't believe in wonderful things happening any longer.
But I will believe in it. Tell me, so changed that what?
That our life together would be a true wedlock. Goodbye.
Nora! Nora! She's gone. Wonderful thing of all.